Blog Talk Radio.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Laurie Smith on Blog Talk Radio. Hello there. I have some guests in the chat room. I'm super glad to be here today. Today's show is an interview with Barbara Hofmeister. She's a renowned speaker. She's an internationally, you know, recognized worldwide speaker, actually. There's just only great stuff to say about Barbara. She's got some information today that she wants to share with us, and she's not here yet, but what I'm going to do is just sort of give you a little bit of idea who she is. Barbara Hofmeister, she lives in Germany, and she is she's a person who helps people to live their dreams. You know, she's one of these people that inspires people to take a look at their own lives and take a look at their dreams that they may have forgotten about, that they may have just, you know, thought that they couldn't achieve and for some reason just gave up on. She's a person who really wants the best for people, and I think that's why she does what she does. She's a passionate person, and she cares about people, and she realized in her own life, you know, that she wanted to live her dreams, that she didn't want to just settle for, you know, for just whatever came along and give up on her dreams and her hopes. And so she realized that so many people, you know, around her were in the same position, and that so many people do. You know, you have these dreams when you're young. You have possibly some amazing dreams when you're a young person, and then life just kind of gets in the way. And then we just, you know, we go day to day just living this life that we really didn't, you know, choose, but we just sort of end up with. You know what I mean? We're just working at a job or doing something that we really didn't really want to do. Maybe we had dreams and aspirations of doing something else, and life just gets in the way. So it happens to everybody. And it's great to see somebody out here who's really inspiring us all to be, you know, what we desire to be. You know, I know that I try to be like that in my own life, but I know I don't stay committed to it. You know, and sometimes I'll start out really strong on a goal or a dream, and then I think, oh, well, you know, it's a lot of work, so I sort of, you know, move on to something else that seems a little easier instead of just going after what I really want. And I think so many times it's just, you know, so many people don't persevere in it, you know what I mean? We just don't do it. And so she's got a book. She wrote a book. It's on the Amazon bestsellers list called To Be or Not To Be, The Choice Is Yours. And she wrote this book. It's actually not just a book. It's a workbook, and it's an amazing book. I went through it, and just reading through it, and I'm going to do it. I'm going to do the workbook, and I know it's really going to make a huge difference in my life. I hope everybody will get a copy of this book. It's amazing what she's done. She spells it out very simply. It's not hard. It's taking a look at what your dreams are. It's not everybody has the same dream, the same goals. You know, it could be something very simple that someone else would say, oh, well, that's not a very big dream, you know what I mean? But to you or to me, it might be exactly what we've been always wanting to do. And so it doesn't matter what the dream is. I really don't think that it does. It's a matter of actually going ahead and allowing ourselves to do it and allowing ourselves to seek it and to go ahead and say, I can do this, you know, and I'm going to meet the challenges that come with it, you know what I mean? And so I really like Barbara. She inspires people all over the world with speaking tours, books. She's got programs. She does training. She has her own personal training website that you can sign up for, you know, inspirational training and really sort of tangible help with these things on how to actually do this, how to achieve our goals, how to achieve our dreams and make it real in our own lives. And she wasn't always, you know, I guess a person could look at her life and say, wow, you know, she had a less than ideal childhood. She grew up abused in communist Germany. She had low self-esteem. You know, she was just inspired to change her life and to go after her dreams. And she just has such a passion for helping other people that she wanted to share with them, you know, that it is possible that a person can truly come from the worst situation and can succeed and can live the life that they really want. And I see this, like when I was looking around on the web just because of this show and looking to see some influential people who, you know, in the past who are very famous now, who didn't start out with much. Some of them didn't start out with anything and created an empire, you know, and they had a dream. They had a goal. They had a vision that they didn't give up on, that they just really put everything into. And it was just something they had to do. And so it's not like we have to start out at a certain place with $1 million and say, okay, here, now I can go from here. It's we just have to make it happen. And so these other people did. And so it really gives you a real good idea that it's completely possible, because these people are examples in front of us. So I was looking around at stuff like that, and there are some amazing stories out there of people that have done these things. And you look at where they came from, and you look at them now, and you're like, wow, that's amazing. And it's just it's great information, to be or not to be. The choice is yours. It really makes you take a look at your own life and your own feelings towards things, and it gets you to answer questions about yourself and about what your dreams really were and what's holding you back. It makes a person take a look at what the obstacles really are, and that they're very much personal the things that would get in the way. For instance, negativity, like low self-esteem, is one huge issue. People might think, well, I'm not good enough to do that. You know, I have this dream, I have this goal, I have this desire to do this one thing, and it's been something I've wanted to do my whole life. And they might have such low self-esteem, you know, anyone, including myself, that we say, oh, I'm not good enough to do that. I don't have what it takes. I'll never succeed. These real negative remarks about ourselves, we might not say them, but we might think them. And we might just think that it's impossible to do because of whether it's our skill level or our intellectual level, you know, or whatever it is. And I just see too many. I'm a person that likes to read success stories, positive success stories, especially from people who have come from really diverse situations, you know, who have started out really behind the eight ball with nothing, you know, and possibly, you know, really had tragic lives and turned it around and made something and did something and really lived their life and lived their dream. And I think it's just amazing that there are so many great examples out there for us just everywhere. If you just take a look around and at some of these stories that are out here, it's amazing, you know what I mean, what people can do. And because so many times I think people think, well, you know, if I only had this or if I only had that, I could really do my dream, you know. Like if I only had a lot of money, I could really make it happen. Or if I only had a certain looks, I could make it happen. Or if I only had, you know, a master's degree, I could make it happen. You know, these types of things, which most of us, I think, would say at some point, you know what I mean? Because some of our goals may be, you know, quite large, and we might think, oh, well, I'd never be able to do it or to accomplish it. I think we have to be very realistic when we're setting our goals. You know, a goal that I had so many years ago, I'll just share this with you. I don't really talk about this on my shows, but a goal that I've had for my whole lifetime was to own and operate a bed and breakfast. And it's just something I've always wanted to do. I love to cook, and I love to bake, and I love to be around people and to, you know, sort of be an encouragement in their life. And I thought, wow, I could be a good bed and breakfast host, you know what I mean? And I think it would be so much fun to do that. And that's a goal and a dream of mine that I've had forever, you know, to it would be more like, instead of a bed and breakfast, it would really be like a small inn. And I kind of wanted more than a couple of bedrooms. I really wanted it to be able to you know, to have about 12 people at any given time. And I just thought that would be so amazing, to cook dinners for them and help them to see the sights around the area and just to get to know these people for a short time and sort of be a positive influence in their lives. And I thought that'd be amazing. And that's a dream of mine. And, you know, I still keep it in the back of my mind. It's something that I wanted to do, you know, later in life, possibly at retirement or something. And there's no reason why I can't achieve that. There's absolutely no reason. It would be me that would be holding myself back, you know, if I don't do that. And that is the absolute truth. And sometimes things come up in life, but we can always strive, right? We can always strive for these goals. I think Barbara's here, so I'm going to go ahead and let her on the air. Hello, is this Barbara?
This is me. Hi, Lori.
Hello. Hello, how are you?
I'm sorry that I'm a bit late, but I couldn't find my phone.
Oh, well, that's okay. That's no problem. That's not a problem at all. We're glad that you're here. This is just amazing. I was just sort of going over a little bit of, you know, of your information about where you came from and what you do and your passion to help people to see that, you know, they can reach their dreams. They can do it. And just talking a little bit about your workbook, the book, the To Be or Not to Be, The Choice is Yours. It's an amazing book.
Thank you.
I love it. I love it.
Thank you. Tell me more.
Well, it inspired me. I tell you, when I started reading it, I was like, wow, I'm going to do this. I'm actually going to commit to it because this is so good. You really spelled it out in a way that it's not complicated. It's clear. It's very simple. You really know how to get people very simply to think about their life, where they're at, what could be holding them back, and write it down in these, you know, in these areas in the workbook, and you know, you can sort of see the progression as it goes, like how helpful that really is, because sometimes we don't even know which direction to go in because we're not thinking in a pattern. So I think that your book is amazing, and I'm just I just love it. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm glad I found my phone now.
Yeah. I'm glad you found your phone, too.
Yeah. I couldn't believe it, you know. I was running around the whole house, so where did I leave it? But I was outside today because it's early evening here in Germany. And I was outside because it was such a beautiful day today, and I left it outside. So there it was. Finally found it. I think the reason why the book is so fairly simple to follow, it's not always easy because some processes just take a little time and they take reflection, and sometimes we don't want to look in those areas of our life that aren't working so well. So, but I think the reason why it's fairly simple to follow is that because I've had to go through all that myself, and this book is like a concentrate of all my or summary of what I went through in the last 33 years since I've become aware that, you know, we do have the power to change our lives. It is in our hands, and we can do something about it. You know, if things are not working, it is in our power to change it. And in the beginning, it was not so easy. I can tell you from my own experience, it wasn't easy. But if you continue walking in the direction that you want to go to in your life, you will for sure get there. You might not become the absolute super, super, super duper success that you might want in the field that you choose. Maybe not, because, but when you analyze that also, when you look at it, you know that you haven't really done all that you needed to do, you know. I mean, I have to say that to myself. I could do more. Mm-hmm. And then I say, why should I? You know, I mean, right, I'm 60, I'm enjoying life, it's good, and I'm sharing my passion with as many people as possible, but marketing is not my cup of tea. So I know if I would do more in that direction, I would become more known to a wider audience. And sometimes I have that slight feeling of guilt, you know, I should really get the word out there that such a tool is available, like the book, that, you know, anybody can follow, no matter where they come from, no matter who they are. And that's when I sometimes struggle a little bit with myself. And I'm just telling this so that people understand that there is no such thing as perfection and you've done everything right and everything works perfectly. No. We have to, you know, choose always. This is why the book is called To Be or Not To Be. The choice is yours, because we always choose whether we do it consciously or not, but we always choose. And I choose not to struggle anymore with my marketing, you know. I thought, okay, I will just put it to the universe that I'm looking for someone that does that part for me, because I'm not very good at it and I don't want to learn it anymore. You know, I don't want to do the stuff that I find difficult for me because I'm not an expert in it, and rather do the things that I really want to do, like write on my blog or write another book, or now I'm on a new project which I love, and that is called Moments to Be. And these are short 1 to 3 minute messages, inspirational messages, practical tips, and I touch all areas of life in those. And and that's really exciting. So that's stuff that I love to do. And so I choose consciously to focus more on the things that I love to do, because I thought, you've done, you know, plenty of years where you did what you didn't love to do so much. It was okay. Right. But now, you know, you come to an age where you can sort of relax a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a new experience, so that's also great.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I think that's just recognizing, you know, that what you really want, which is to do, which is what you were saying, is not so much the marketing side. You'd rather leave that to somebody else who that is their dream, that's their goal, and focus on what you really love about what you do. And that's helping people, and that's, you know, continuing on with your passion to really make a difference in people's lives, like you're saying, with these, you know, with these daily sort of, you know, messages to people and you know, moments to be and things like this. Like, that's great. And I think that's your passion, and that's your gift, and that's what you're good at. And I think that's amazing. And I love what you're doing. I absolutely love it, and I think it's so wonderful. It's very inspirational to everyone, you know. And I'm a person who, like, I'm a glass half full person, you know. I just choose to be that way. You know, because it can hit you.
Exactly.
You know, yeah. Life can throw curveballs at you, and if you're just going to be a glass half empty person, it can be really bad. You know, but if you keep that vision that no, things can get better. You know, things will get better, and I can make the choices to make sure that they are better. You know what I mean? It does. It gives you some hope, and it gives you some realization that hey, even in the trials of our lives, the things that come up and things that happen, we can still, you know, so we can still seek after, you know, what brings us hope and what gives us that hope to keep going and keep moving. And I like, you know, and that's just in everyday life. But then you take a look at something like, you know, this beautiful gift of a book that you've written. Really, it's a gift, and I think it's just amazing. You know, a person can just sit down and, like I was saying, you know, it doesn't matter what your dream, what a person's dream or goal is. It's whatever that dream or goal is. It doesn't, like, my dream is probably going to be completely different than somebody else's dream
mm-hmm.
life, you know. And, you know, it doesn't matter if it's that somebody wants to be the top CEO executive of some sort of corporation, or if somebody just wants to have, their dream would be to have a garden in the backyard that was just the most beautiful garden in the world. I mean, it's whatever your dream is, you know, that we can achieve these things, you know, that we can actually do this. And I think this is so needed for people. I think that, you know, people can really benefit from your book and from your websites and your information and your blog talk show here. You're a blog talk show host. And, you know, I think it's just awesome. Your message is really awesome, and it's so needed, because so many people, I think, around the world just say, oh, it's never going to happen. You know, they do a lot of self-talk, you know, a lot of negative self-talk.
Mm.
Never be able to do it.
Fortunately, yeah.
Yeah, well, I've done it myself, and that's why I know it's so easy to do, to fall into that trap of, oh, it's not going to work out, or, oh, I need a master's degree to do that, and I can't do it. And, you know, and really putting these roadblocks up in our lives so that we don't, that we just think, oh, well. And I wonder if that's just some sort of self-sabotage, so that we don't have to go out and seek after that goal or that dream.
Yeah, it is. It definitely is self-sabotage, because, you know, I hear it all the time that people say, oh, well, it's easy for you to say, you know, look where you are.
Mm-hmm.
I say, yeah, but look where I came from. You know,
right.
I mean, that's the whole point. That's the whole point. Look where I came from, and look where you came from, you know, and why should I be able to do things and you not? That doesn't make sense. And I can give hundreds of examples. I mean, hundreds, literally, or thousands, if I really think about it, of
right.
people that come from a really tough background, that had a tough youth. A lot of them, and that is true, they go under, you know, they become criminal or what have you. Why? Because they think that this is how it, you know, this is where I come from, I'm no better than the rest of my family, and for instance, I mean, just talking about
that's
examples,
right.
And who am I to think that I can be something better? That is
right.
absolute BS, because we can be whatever we want to be. If
mm-hmm.
I mean, we can look at in America, you have fantastic examples, Oprah Winfrey, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
She comes from a really bad background. Wrong side of town, very bad background, I think alcoholism, drug abuse, and what have you. And look where she is today,
mm-hmm.
and where she has been
right.
for quite some time, right?
Yeah, she's a good example, a shining example, absolutely.
Very shining example. Of course, that's what I meant earlier. Not all of us are going to get to that height of a career, you know. Not all of us are going to be the richest one of the richest people in the country or in the world even. But that's not necessary, because for most of us, that's not our real dream. That's not what we really want.
Mm-hmm.
But we, first of all, I think the most important thing that is missing in people's lives is that they don't have a clear direction in their life. They don't know what they really want. It's
mm-hmm.
much easier to say what you don't want than it seems to be to say what you do want.
Right. That's so true. I think people just don't think about what they really want so many times. You know, they just...
Because they think they are not deserving, they think they are not good enough, they think it's not possible for them. So before you even start dreaming in earnest, you sort of push it down and say, but that's just not possible. You're too old, you don't have the right education, look where you come from, who would listen to you, and all that kind of self-talk that we give to ourselves, unfortunately.
Right.
And that's something that we deal with, of course, also in the book, because it's so, so, so important. If you don't believe in yourself, who will?
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's exactly right. Yeah. And I think so many people, you know, sadly enough, I've seen so many people, and I've even done it myself, you know, have just given up sometimes, you know what I mean, and just said, oh, I can't do it. And, you know, and that's a real shame, you know what I mean, because we're just hurting ourselves, you know what I mean? You're right. It's just having a vision. It's having a clear idea about what we want to do and then going after it. You know what I mean? Whatever it is. And knowing that, you know, I mean, we have to be very clear about what we really want to end up with and where we really want to end up. And that's why I like your book, because it sort of says, you know, to start at the end. You know what I mean?
Exactly. The first chapter is start with the end in mind. And people ask me, how can I start with the end? You know, I mean, I have to start at the beginning. I said, yeah, but that's, you know, where did that starting at the beginning get you? So
mm-hmm.
obviously it's not working too well, because we get so, first of all, we get very, very quickly distracted, especially today, because there are so many distractions and life is very short. You know, everything's very fast and happening
mm-hmm.
now. And
that's
we
right.
don't really know anymore what is the foundation, what is the core of my being, of my dreams, the core of who I am, you know, who do I want to become? All those questions are sort of left aside. And I was just reading today again the Celestine Prophecy, and I can recommend that to anybody and everybody. That is my absolute favorite book.
Mm-hmm.
It's by James Redfield. Absolutely amazing. And it talks about the history of mankind also, and why we became so focused on materialistic things, for instance, and got
mm-hmm.
so away from spirituality and from who we really are.
Mm-hmm.
Because when we start going back to that, then we don't need all these material things. They are nice if we have them, but they are not necessary at all. And we start to realize that I am enough. You know, inside of me, there is nothing but love, pure love, and this is who I am, unconditional love. And when, you know, for the people that have an awakening and actually experience this unconditional love, it's so powerful. It's so, I can't even explain it. Every time I try to explain it, I don't even know how to. It's just so powerful when you get to that very core of who you are, that you
mm-hmm.
know that you are more than good enough. You are creation, and that means also you are the creator, or part of, you know, I mean, you're part of creation,
mm-hmm.
you're part of the creator. That
That's
also
right.
means that you influence, and today with quantum physics, we also know that our thoughts influence the outcomes that we get.
Mm-hmm.
So now we don't have any real arguments anymore against it, you know. We can't
right.
say, oh, it's circumstances, you know, easy for you to talk. It's my circumstances are totally different. They are miserable. Well, I would like to invite the people from America to go to a third world country and see how people there can be happy, even so they have absolutely nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And they really struggle against corruption and all kinds of, against disease and what have you. And still,
oh, yeah.
they are happy people. Why? Because they search for the happiness, and they are grateful for what they have, for the very, very little they have. But we have so much, we don't have the time to be grateful. And that's something that we need to change, really. To adopt an attitude of gratitude, that's the first thing that I do with my coaching clients, the very first thing. I discuss it with them, you know, to see where they stand. Do they do it on a regular basis? Some people think, oh, that's religious. You know, I have to give thanks to God, but I'm not religious. No, it has, for me, it has nothing to do with religion. It's a good part of it, and it's good. But everybody of us, if we give thanks every day, and we can just give thanks, we don't have to give thanks to God. If that's not our desire, or we don't have to give thanks to Allah or whoever might be, you know, who we believe in, that's
correct.
Up to every single person. We can give thanks to higher powers. We can give thanks to ourselves or our families or whoever. It doesn't really matter. But we must start seeing the good that we have in our life. And I really mean that. And I recommend that people, before they go to sleep at night, give thanks for all the good things that happened in the day.
So I think, yeah, that's awesome. I used to do that. I kind of got away from it, but I used to actually do that.
Yeah, sometimes we, it happens to me too. But normally I do it every day. And I really try to remember also every night before I go to sleep, because it lets you go to sleep on a very positive note, thinking of the good things. And if, especially when you had a bad day, you know, when you had a tough day and not a good day, and you think, well, what can I give thanks for today? Everything went wrong today. You know, that was not a good day today.
And,
I mean, it happens to all of us. But then you start looking for something you can give thanks for. And it can be something as small as a bird song or a child smiling at you or, you know, whatever. I mean, it can be any small thing, or that, you know, you could sleep late because it was Sunday, or, you know, that the sun was shining, or it was a nice sunset, or a friend called that you haven't spoken to for a while, whatever it might be. Don't, you know, people need to get away from thinking it has to be something massive.
Right.
The small things make the difference in life. The small things are what destroy marriages, for instance. It's the small things, not the big things. And the same is the small things that make our life worth living and make our life worthwhile and enjoyable. And also, when you do that, when you make that a habit, you start looking every day for something. You know you have to, I say minimum three, better five or more things that you are grateful for. Minimum three. So my coaching clients have to send me an email every night before they go to bed with a minimum of three things that they're grateful for in a day. I do that not because I'm interested, but because I want them to make it a habit. And that's an obligation. And so they go to sleep on a positive note. They start noticing small things that are good in their life. They start noticing all the things that are good in their life, which I think is essential. And then they go to sleep in a positive way. In the morning, before getting up, I give thanks again. I give thanks for the good things that I'm looking forward to in the day, so that I get up on a positive note. So I get up looking forward to the day. My father told me that. He said to me, I remember I was 19 or something like that. I came home at 4:30 from the disco. And my father was ready to go to work. So he was having breakfast. And I asked him, I said, how can you look so cheerful at 4:30 in the morning? You know, I mean, you've got a 16, 18-hour day ahead. And he looked up and he said, Barbara, you don't understand. My work is my hobby. I look forward to the day. And I thought, wow, what a concept, you know? And it took years before I finally understood it. You know, I mean, I didn't think like that at all when I was 19. But some years later, I remembered that, and I thought, wow, that's a great concept, because that's how you can enjoy almost any work, because you can really say, okay, I have chosen, nobody forced you to do any particular job. You have chosen that, and as you've chosen it, you might as well choose to enjoy it and be good at it.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, and when people do that, I can tell you, they get different results. They get respected much faster by their peers and by their bosses, and they rise up faster in their careers. Why? Because they have such a positive attitude. They have a can-do attitude.
Mm-hmm.
And not, oh, this is difficult, or why doesn't she do it, or why doesn't he do it, and it's their job. No, if you have that attitude, then forget it. You know, then, especially today, it's, you know, you've got to be better than others, and you can be better just by having a better attitude. I remember Jim Rohn used to say, always, when you work at McDonald's, you get minimum pay. I don't know if that's still the case. But as soon as you wear the hat, you already show a positive attitude towards the company, and they pay you a dollar more per hour.
Oh, yeah.
Just for the positive attitude. So,
yeah.
So it's
that's
still
right.
Like that. Yeah.
Right.
So that's how it works. And that's how it works in the marketplace. We don't get paid for the hours we are at work. We get paid for the value that we bring. And the value we bring not in the hours, we bring with our attitude and with the way that we do our work and with the way that we take it as ours. You know, we have to own it and
mm-hmm.
we have to make it ours, whether it's our own company or whether we are working for someone else or whatever it might be.
Right.
So,
yeah.
Sorry,
that's
I,
right.
I
No, that's awesome. Yeah, well, that's just it. And our attitudes have everything to do with it. And, you know, that's something that I have to remind myself all the time. You know, a lot of people do that, you know, to keep a good attitude, right? Because it's easy to get sort of, maybe just bored with the job or,
mm-hmm.
you know, and thinking, oh, this is just every day the same old thing, you know. I've had jobs like that where it's just, you know, I wasn't looking forward to going in, you know. And when I first started the job, I really enjoyed it. And then after a few years, you know, it started to wear me down and the attitude within the place wasn't good and everybody was down. And so it kind of wore off on me and then I was down. And that's not good, you know. And I realized that wasn't good for me and I actually got out of it. And, you know, still seek places where I can make a difference, you know what I mean, and where, you know, I can be a team player and I can be an encouragement to other people. That's where my passion is, you know what I mean,
mm-hmm.
is just to be a team player and to be, you know, an encouragement to and a positive sort of influence, you know, and a positive person. And so, yeah, it's important for me to find places like that to work or to do my thing. Because that's how I operate my life, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, but once in a while, I mean, I'll see my attitude kind of slipping and I'll be like, well, you know, I got to get my attitude in check because, you know, that's definitely going to influence where I end up and what I'm going to be doing and how people are going to treat me and how people are going to perceive me, you know what I mean? So it has everything to do with us.
It has everything to do with us, absolutely.
And sometimes that's hard to look at, like you were saying. I mean, sometimes we don't want to see these things, you know, that we might need to change, that, you know, are some of the behaviors that we might take on and some of the belief systems that we take on that, you know, it's like, oh, well, you know, life is just, you know, it's just a bummer and it's never done me any good and these types of statements, and, you know.
Yeah.
That's not a good, that's, you really don't get far doing that, saying those types of things. It just doesn't lead to anything positive. It doesn't lead to any kind of creative thinking, you know what I mean? And so, I mean, I try to, you know, to try to not think like that and just think, no, because, you know, today is today, I'll live today, but tomorrow's another day, you know, and I just got to keep the hope alive that, you know, tomorrow I'll just keep working on it and keep working on it, you know, because like you said, nobody's perfect and there's no such thing as perfection, you know what I mean? But I think we're all working towards what is perfection in our own lives. In our own self, you know, and it's just a work in progress all the time. And I think that's why I really like the way that you do what you do. I really like your message, and I like your vision, and I like what you're doing, because what it does is encourages people to say, you know, yeah, I can truly do, I can do this. You know what I mean? Like, this is tangible. This is something I can do. And that's, like, when I was going through your workbook, that's what I noticed, is that this is something that people can, this is definitely something that people can say, okay, I've always had a dream, you know, and I'm going to find out how to get there. And you basically show people, you know, how to do this themselves, how to get it, how to make it happen.
I think that's a big difference to most other books out there, and that's why I wrote the book, because I started writing it out of frustration, because I just bought another 5 books from Amazon, and I mean, I've been in personal development now for 33 years, which is a long time, and you know, I have hundreds and hundreds of self-help books of all kinds. And I just ordered another 5, and I went through them, and I got really frustrated, because in the sales pitch, you know, in the short blurb that they all post, I thought they offered that they would give all the answers. And I thought, okay, let's see what they have to say, because I'm always learning. I still go to seminars today as an attendee as much as I give them, you know. For me, this is important. And so I bought those books, and I got them, and I went through them, and I thought, well, this is the same thing again, you know. They give a lot of platitudes, but apart from that, they also tell you what to do but not how to do it. And that really got to me. And I thought, this is frustrating. I mean, just imagine if you don't have the how-tos, if you don't have the tools, and you buy books like this, you get so frustrated because you think there is something wrong with you. Because they promise you the answers, then you buy the book, and at the end of the book you say, yeah, good for them, but how do I do it?
Right.
And you get frustrated. You feel that you're dumb, that you didn't understand it, you know. What's wrong with me? Why don't I get it? Now I have so many books already of this genre, I still don't get it. You go to seminars, you don't get it. Why? Mm-hmm. Because they don't give you all the answers. And that was getting to me. I was having breakfast one morning with an American friend of mine, and I told him about my frustration, and he started laughing, and he said, yeah, it's about time that you write it. And I said, what, me? And 10 minutes later, he sort of looked up from his food, and he said, I'm serious, Barbara, you should write this book. You're so passionate about it, you've got the answers, give, you know, share them. I said, I do that in workshops. He said, yeah, but you can't be everywhere and you don't want to be everywhere. So, you know, this is a good way of doing it, of, you know, in a book. So I thought about it and I thought, wow, he actually caught me red-handed because, you know, I was doing the opposite of what I preach, because I always say, when you don't complain unless you're willing to do something about it. And there I was complaining, not doing anything about it, right? So I caught myself. And the second thing is, I always say, I walk my talk, walk your talk. Yeah, but I wasn't walking my talk there, you know. So I caught myself. And I thought, oh, look at this. You know, you actually catch yourself at not walking your talk.
Mm-hmm.
Barbara, this is, you know, bad news, bad news. And so I sat down that afternoon and I thought about it, and I actually wrote the outline for the book and the table of content on that very first afternoon when he gave me that idea. And that stayed exactly as I wrote it on that afternoon. It just sort of flowed out of me and it stayed like that. I rewrote the content you don't know how many times, because each time my editor sent it back and said, okay, now it's great, we can put it into print, I had a new idea. So that's with perfectionism, you know, because in print it's like it's forever, you know. I don't know who will read it in 50 years or 100 years from today. So it's like, oh, yeah, no, but I could, you know, just this sentence doesn't sound so fantastic, so you could change it, or maybe this little paragraph. And, oh, my God, I mean, I was getting on my own nerves, but I was definitely getting on my editors. And but I know that it was worthwhile, because I hear from the feedback that I get from people like yourself, or from the, you know, people on Amazon that just leave feedback or something, I know that it's really working for people, and that is, for me, so humbling, because I wrote the book with the intention of giving people the tools and the techniques so that they can do it by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And it's one thing doing it with intention, is another thing when you get the feedback that it actually works.
Right. That's
yeah,
right.
Because, you know, I have different experience and different knowledge than you and anybody else. So I wasn't sure if, you know, I wrote it with that intention, so, you know, I wrote it in as simple as possible ways, so there's not much theory in there, so that anybody really finds the practicability and can relate to it and can actually do it and follow it. But until I got the first two feedbacks, I wasn't sure, you know.
Right, how it was going to be perceived.
Yeah,
really,
because you don't know, you know, you don't know what is, you know, how will other people understand it? Will they understand it in the way that I meant it, or will they sort of make a misinterpretation because they have different perception than I have?
Mm-hmm.
But
right.
It's working anyway, so that's the good news. It's really working for people, and I have clients all over the world that are using it, and they're following it. And I know in Russia there's a few groups that are actually using it for workshops. They use the book, mm-hmm. and they follow the book in workshops, and I am really proud of that.
Yeah, well, that's it's a huge, I think it's just an awesome thing, because, I mean, it's probably a humbling thing too, but it's also so good, because this is where your passion, this is where this whole, you know, where what you do and walking, you know, first of all, talking the talk, walking it out. This is where your passion is to help people. And so then when you find out, wow, okay, people are getting something out of the book, and it is helping, and it does make sense to them. I mean, that's got to be a sense of satisfaction as well, and a sense of gratitude and gratification.
No end,
Yeah, for sure. And I think I think it's great. I went through and I actually scrolled through the workbook, and I'm going to do it. I'm going to do the whole thing from start to finish. And I'll let you know how it goes.
interested always.
Oh, it's amazing. It's so amazing. And I think it's because it is simple. You don't have to read through 50,000 pages just to get to one section where you get to write a couple things down. You really keep it very simple and focused, and it's just, you know, it just touches on exactly what it needs to touch on to get people to think about where they are in their life and what they need to do and what their fears are and what they, you know, what they're afraid of and what keeps them back and holds them back from even going after their dream life, you know, or going after these things. You know, so lots of people may have a dream, but they keep it just that. It's just a dream. You know, it's just never going to come to
pass. Yeah, and many people sweep it under the carpet, you know. It's like, you know, we all had dreams when we were young, but then life gets in the way, and we feel that, you know, soon we can feel that there are more obligations than dreams. We don't have time for dreams anymore. But I have to wake people up. Anybody that's listening, please listen carefully. Unless you know where you want to take your life and who you want to become in this lifetime, you will not get there, because mm-hmm. you don't even know where there is. And that means that you can work as hard as you want. You will not find the satisfaction that you are seeking, that fulfillment, because that fulfillment comes with really living your dream, with really having a purpose, with really seeing the big picture of your life. You know, however long your life might be or however short it might be, but if you walk towards that big picture, this is what gives you the satisfaction. And each day you take one step closer, and it's not a quantum leap either.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it feels like a quantum leap, you know, because you've taken so many small steps that now suddenly you have a breakthrough and it feels like a massive difference. But you've done it yourself. It was in your hands, and you chose to walk that path, and you did it a little bit and another little bit every single day, step by step by step. This is also how I teach goals. We all need to set goals. We must set goals, but most people don't follow them. Why? Because if they have big goals, then they are overwhelming. So they give up halfway or even earlier. It's like what we do with our New Year resolutions. You know, it's like, okay, 31st mm-hmm. of December, we have to make some resolutions. What are we going to do better next year? What motivation is behind that? None.
Right?
So this is
right.
Why by the 10th of January we've forgotten about it, or we stopped exercising already. You know, all the things that we wanted to do are quickly forgotten. Why? Because we don't have a motivation. We need the motivation behind it. If we have the idea of what we really want that drives us, that turns us on, then we have to look at why do we want this? Why? And again, Jim Rohn says, if the why is strong enough, the how becomes easy. Tony Robbins calls himself the why man because it's all about the why. And it's not about the how, it's about the why. Why do you want something so badly? Mm-hmm. You know, what does it do for you? What would it do for you when you have it? How would you feel? And this is why I take them also already in the first chapter. We talk about that big vision. And I ask people to describe that vision in every tiny little detail. And I share a half an hour of my ideal day, maybe mm-hmm. half an hour maximum. And that's 3 pages. This is what I mean with detail, descriptive, vivid. You've mm-hmm. got to live it. And this is when our subconscious, which is about 95 to 97% of our thoughts, I mean, that's almost 100%, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah.
that subconscious starts to help us. And this is where our true power lies, in our subconscious. This is why it's so important to get emotional. Not only systematic. Men are, you know, women are much more emotional than men, and men are more systematic than women.
Mm-hmm.
Systemized. Okay, the system is important if you really want to, you know, be successful in business. But first of all, you've got to know the passion. Where is your passion? Who are you? Who you want to become? Where do you still want to go with your life? And then you need to see that outcome. You need to see that place. Where will you be? And mm-hmm. I ask people always, look, if you continue as you have been doing the last few years, where will you be 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years from today? And does that picture that you get when you look down the road, when you look into your future, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years from now, does that picture turn you on? Is that satisfying? Is
right.
that, oh, yeah, fantastic, hooray? For most people, it's like, ugh.
I know. It's like, no, I don't
yeah.
want to see that.
Okay, so you don't want to see that, so you need to do something about it, right? Otherwise, it's going to happen. It's going to happen just like that.
Yeah.
And time passes so fast, I tell you, the older you get, the faster it flies. It's just crazy.
Oh,
and so we don't have time to waste. We can't wait until it might happen by accident because it's
right.
probably not going to happen. So we need to start now, right this moment. And we need to start by making a small adjustment, not this massive adjustment. People say
mm-hmm.
to me, but I have to put food on the table. Of course you have to. I'm not saying leave your job today if you don't like it.
Mm-hmm.
But,
that's right.
you know, work on it step by step. I have a local group here in my small community where I live that I do a workshop for once a month. It's free of charge, just for the community. And I have this young man in there. He's 31 years old. And he says, you know, he comes to every workshop. It's mostly women, but this guy comes to everyone.
Yeah,
and
that's awesome.
Yeah, it's great. He really wants a change. And
mm-hmm.
he was unhappy with his relationship, unhappy with his work. Well, so far, he's ended the relationship. Now he is unhappy, which I can understand, because if you've been in a relationship for several years, you know, even so
yeah.
you were not happy, when you leave it, you are not 100% sure if it was the right thing, and you feel lonely, you don't know,
right.
should I have done that, maybe I shouldn't, but I'm glad I don't tell him what to do. That's his own choice, right? It's his life.
Mm-hmm.
I just
right.
let him look down the road. You want to stay in this? Look down the road, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. Is that what you want? And with him, it was very clear. It was 500% not what he wanted.
mm-hmm.
So I'm glad he's you know, finally changing something. But I give him the time to do that whenever he is ready, whenever he can really make that decision for himself, because
right.
it has nothing to do with me, right?
No. Right.
So I don't tell people what to do ever. I just, you know, ask them to look into their life, reflect on their life. Is this what you want, the life that you lead like right now? If it's not, then what is stopping you from changing?
Mm-hmm.
What is stopping you? I was talking to a lady a few weeks ago on the phone, and she said to me, "Well, Barbara, you know, I used to be a person that was all very social. I went out all the time. I was talking to all my neighbors, doing a lot in the local community. But now I'm not feeling so well." I said, "Well, what's the problem?" "Oh, well, I'm so overweight, and I've got diabetes, and I've got this, and high blood pressure, and this, and that, and that. And my bones don't carry me so well." I said, "Well, obviously, if you carry too much weight, you know, I mean, obviously, you're getting older, your body can't carry all of that, you know."
It's hard, yeah.
Yeah, and also, of course, the diabetes comes from that, and the high blood pressure comes from that. So it all has one root.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, "Well, how did you start all of this? How did you get into this routine of eating too much?" She said, "Well, there were some frustrating times, and I ate a little bit more, and I started snacking in the evening, and I started moving less, and this and that, you know. And over the years, it's added up to where she's now." And
mm-hmm.
I said, "Well, are you going to do something about it?" She said, "Well, I don't know what to do because the state that I'm in now is really miserable." I said, "Well, I can't give you the solution for that, you know, but you know the cause of what got you into this problem, and you know the solution yourself. You know that you need to change your diet."
Mm-hmm.
"And I'm not saying go on a diet. I mean change what you eat, change your eating habits,
mm-hmm.
and you can eat as much as you did before, but just much healthier things. So that you start get energy again and start to want to move again and start to get that diabetes down. And with good food, you can totally get rid of diabetes." I mean, you know, people are not aware of that. I read something that 96% of people that had a quadruple bypass operation were back in their old eating and living habits only 9 months after they had the operation. Can you imagine that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I believe it, though, because that's just that old, you know, situation where so many people, including myself. I mean, I may as well throw myself in here too. Just have these ways of living that, for whatever reason, we don't change. You know what I mean?
Mm.
And I think it's sad to see this, and you know, you just always think, "Well, yeah, how come this person can't, you know, do this or can't do that?" Like, my big thing is I smoke cigarettes, and I've been trying to quit. I did quit for a year and a bit, but I've been smoking forever. And I've been always kind of thinking, "Oh, it'd be great to be a non-smoker." I did feel better when I quit. I was able to quit before, and I thought, you know, I'll quit for good. And it's about a year and a half ago I picked them back up. So now I'm like, "Well, that was just stupid." And, you know, I felt so much better when I wasn't smoking. I saved money when I wasn't smoking. And, you know, and now here I am back in this old habit of, you know, because I did it for so long. Some part of me, so you're so right, Barbara, like when it comes down to it, these are things that, you know, if I don't change this, you know, then it's not going to happen. You know what I mean? If I don't make the necessary, you know, you can't just, there's no magical, you know, thing that just will just wipe that away and just, you know, take that burden off my shoulders. I mean, I'm going to have to be committed to do this. And that's really what I got from your book, you know, the to be or not to be, the choice is yours. You know, you have to be committed. It's not just going to happen. It's not going to land in your lap, you know. It's gonna.
Yeah, I wish. I said at one stage in the book, I think I say I'm not a genie. Otherwise, I would give it to you, but I can't. You've got to give it to yourself, and that is unfortunately true. For instance, I should exercise more. I should move more. You know, I don't do enough. I know that I should. I know that I should, and I keep promising myself, but then I don't.
Mm-hmm.
And then I start again, and then I stop again. You know, so we are all weak in some ways, in some areas, but we've got to look at the consequences. If we continue like this, if you continue smoking, you know, where you're going to be. I mean, my cousin is dying just now because he was drinking too much. He had a pub, so, you know, normal thing. When you have a pub, you drink something with your clients and so on. So he is 59 years old, and he's ready to go.
Mm-hmm.
And he's not ready, I mean, but he needs to go now, you know.
Right, the body just breaking down.
Yeah, the body has just given up.
Right.
And we've got to be aware of that, that this can happen to us. And is that what we want?
Right, right.
And
right, because,
obviously,
yeah.
It's not what we want. So what are we willing to do about it? Because
right.
Comfort zone, you know, I mean, when you don't change your habit of smoking, or I don't change my habit of not exercising enough, it just is because it's become a habit to do whatever we do, or whatever in my case we don't do.
Mm-hmm.
It's become a habit. It feels comfortable. It's just part of our everyday normal lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
And so it feels comfortable, but our comfort zone has nothing to do with comfort, really, because
mm-hmm.
why would people stay in abusive relationships, for instance?
Mm-hmm.
Why would
That's
they
right.
do that? They
right.
do that because it's their comfort zone. It's what they got used to because it happened over time. It didn't happen overnight. They didn't get married, and the next day they got beaten up.
Mm-hmm.
Or even yeah. before they got married. You know, I mean, sometimes women, especially women, stay in relationships like that for years. And I think,
mm-hmm.
why?
Right.
Why would you do that to yourself? Yeah, but I
yeah.
don't know what will happen to me when I leave.
Right.
But I
the
do know what happens. I say, yeah, you do know what happens to you when you stay. You get hurt all the time. You have fear when you go home.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
right.
That
yep.
that's dreadful. I mean, that is definitely destructive. That is self-destroying yourself,
mm-hmm.
self-sabotage at its worst. And still we don't change. Why? Because we don't have a strong enough reason why. If
mm-hmm.
our why is strong enough, then the how becomes easy. When women have children and the husband starts beating the children, they are gone in the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
They took it on themselves. That wasn't so bad. Even so, I think it's really bad, but that wasn't so bad. But when the husband touches the kids, that's when they become lionesses.
Mm-hmm.
And this is when the why is strong enough. When you have enough pain
right.
in whichever area, you will take the measure and you will change. Unfortunately, you might not change for good, you know, like in your case with cigarettes,
mm-hmm.
you started again. And in the case of the quadruple bypass people, they've gone back again, you know, to their old
right.
and bad eating habits and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so the why has to be there. The motivation has to be there. I always
right.
say there's three things really to success in life, in whichever area. Number one, you got to know what you want. That is the absolute foundation, the absolute basis, the minimum that everybody has to work on, and 95% of people don't have a clear direction. This is scary.
Mm-hmm.
This is scary. The number is scary. And
mm-hmm.
this is why we have so much frustration and why we have so many unhappy, depressed people who are trying to kid themselves by taking drugs and
mm-hmm.
you know, drinking too
yep.
much and doing all kinds of destructive things.
Mm-hmm.
So that's
yeah,
the first
right.
thing really people need to, you know, work on becoming clear of what they truly want. Who do I want to become? Who am I? Who am I? Okay, that's a deep question that you can't answer in a sec. I've been in February.
Right.
I was in upstate New York in a retreat. 5 days we did nothing but ask each other, who are you? Five
wow.
days. We talked about nothing but that topic, and we didn't discuss it. We just asked the question for 5 days, nonstop. Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? And it's amazing what comes up. First, you try to
yeah.
cover it up. You come up with all kinds of superficial stuff. You know, I'm Barbara Hofmeister. I'm the author. I'm the this and that. Rhubarb, that's not who you are. That's
right.
stuff that you have created in your life, you know. That's part of your life. Yeah, it's something that you have done, but it's not who you are. It's not the essence of you. So these are things that I find really important and challenging and very interesting. But I don't ask clients to, I mean, I don't ask my readers to go that deep because that takes some doing. takes more than a book, unfortunately, to get there for most people, not for all people.
Right. Maybe that's another future book.
That could be. It's really interesting. I have a book in the works that I meant to publish this spring, but I'm not quite happy with it yet. So it needs to simmer, and I am very excited about the moments to be, and that's like a full-time thing at the moment. But yeah, sure. I don't know if I'm the right person really to write that book. We shall see, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I am open
right.
to it. But in my book, for instance, I talk a lot about fears. I talk about worries. I talk about our values, our belief system. This is so important to understand. Most people never thought about it. Why do they do what they do?
Right. Well, yeah, exactly. What actually motivates you to do what you do? Yeah.
Yeah, and what triggers you to be unhappy? What triggers you to be frustrated? You know, because there are triggers in our lives, and those triggers are automatic. We are not consciously getting ourselves upset or angry or whatever. It's not, you know, we don't say to ourselves, okay, time to get upset now. No, it just happens. And something triggers it. And whatever triggers is where one of our beliefs is hiding, you know. Something that we've most probably learned when we were small kids and that served us then. And because our parents maybe told us something, or a teacher or someone in kindergarten or our grandparents or whatever, they told us a lesson. And we accepted it as the truth. It had nothing to do with whether it's really true or not. I mean, absolutely nothing to do with reality. It's just that something that maybe at age 3 we accepted as the truth because a figure of authority told us this is how it is, whatever it might be. And we took it as the truth, and it's still there. And still today for us, that is the truth. That's how it
right.
is. And we feel good when things are run on that truth. That's when we feel comfortable. But as soon as something sort of is done in a different way, we feel uncomfortable because it's not right. You know, it's about being right or wrong. And I know T. Harv Eker always says, you're either right or you're rich. And I like that, you know? Because he says, who's right? I mean, who knows who's right? Because we all have different opinions. We have different backgrounds, different education, what have you. Who knows what's right? But the result, you know, you've got to know what is the result that you want. Why do you want it? And then take consistent, inspired action. And with inspired action, I mean make sure that every action you take, you know, what you spend especially major time on, is going towards that outcome that you want. This is important
right.
because we work so often in, you know, we are all over the place, especially we women. We multitask on top of everything else. And,
right.
you know, and we are all over the place, and we forget very quickly what we really set out to do.
It's easy. That can happen. It can happen so fast because you get sidetracked. And then something will come up, something, and then, you know, before you know it, half a year has gone by, and what you were thinking about doing, you know, is just gone. And it seemed at the time, you know, to be something that was so important, and it was just so meaningful, and it was going to help you or whatever, and then it's just gone because you get sidetracked and just lost in this, you know, world of go, 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 you know, without, you know, that's why I like really what your book does is actually allows you to write it down first of all so that you don't lose it, and a place to work from, you know what I mean? It's a real place to work from to actually so that you don't lose track of these things, because it's so easy, and you know, so many times people have so much going on in their lives. I mean, it's no wonder. But if it is important to us, really, like you were saying, I mean, so many people are so miserable because they don't really know what they want to do. They don't really know who they are even. I mean, I know so many people that, you know, could be feeling this at any given time, just thinking, I don't even know what I want, you know? Like, what do I really want? And this is you know, if it's kind of, it's a shame that, you know, this sort of happens to people, you know what I mean? That we get to the point where we don't even realize what it is that our dreams are anymore. And I think so many times when we're young, you know, we're just starting out young, you know, children and young adults and thinking, wow, I want to be this or I want to do that. And with some, I actually look back at some of that stuff that I was looking at wanting to do. And, you know, today it would be completely different. I don't want to do those things at all.
Mm-hmm.
But there's, you know, some things that actually stuck with me. And I thought, yeah, this is, would be something that I definitely would like to do. And yet, you know, for whatever reason, I just haven't, I haven't been motivated enough to say, that's got to be what I go after. That's got to be it. And, you know, at the end of the road, I want to see myself and where I'm going to be, you know, when I achieve that. And what's it going to mean in my life? Exactly. Like, what is, what's the importance of it? What is the relevance of it?
Yeah,
and so many, yeah, unless we're asking these questions, we're going to continue on the same old path. I'm just going to keep on smoking. You know, I'm going to just keep on, you know, keep on doing what I've been doing. And it's not going to get me anywhere but the same old thing. You know what I mean? And so really, if we are unhappy with our lives, we are ultimately responsible because we are making the choices. We are making the choices.
And in the word responsible, I love this English word responsible because it has the two words in there that, that sort of shows us how to do it. Responsible means able to respond, right? Response able.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that you are able to respond. Not the circumstances make or break you. What you do with the circumstances, that is what makes or breaks you.
Mm-hmm.
Because you are able to respond to any type of situation. And you can see the same people in similar situations react totally different, totally different. You know, some get fearful, others take action, some become, you know, take charge, they take leadership. And it's the same situations for every single person, but totally different reaction within the group of people. This
mm-hmm.
is why they do seminars for team building or what have you, just to see how people work together in a dangerous situation, for instance, you know, in
mm-hmm.
a potentially dangerous situation.
Right.
And it's really interesting to see who's taking charge. And so quite often I see small women like myself, you know, that we've got these big guys in the group. I was in Malaysia last year and we were doing this adventure stuff, you know, and I love doing this stuff even so, you know, I'm not very good at it, but I love doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And we had these big men, you know, muscles, strong guys, and I'm about a quarter size of them. And, but you can see, and I saw that in several groups, that quite frequently the women take charge and they say, okay, this is who does what. You know, you are big, you do this, you are this, you boom, boom. And within minutes, you know, the group is organized, stuff is getting done. And I'm like, wow, look at those ladies, you know, they really go for it. And it's wonderful to see that. But unless we get challenged, we don't show that we have that ability, and we all have it.
Right.
And
yeah,
so
we wouldn't
need
even
to
realize.
Challenge ourselves, because too many of us live a mediocre life because we don't challenge ourselves. We just
mm-hmm.
sort of think, okay, my family's always been in this business, so I stay in this business. You know, my family has been, I don't know, in the police force or army or doesn't matter, medical.
Right.
This is why I start in that profession. Okay, so you start in that profession, you don't like it, get out. You know,
right.
Do something that you do like, or get into a department that you enjoy working in, you know, that has the type of challenges that you enjoy, because we need to challenge ourselves so that we can, you know, make the best of our life and make the best of ourselves also.
Mm-hmm. That's
in
right, and we won't.
Sorry.
You go ahead.
Now, in Ukraine, I was working quite often in Ukraine, former Soviet Union. And there, all women without one single exception that I've met there, had one dream, and that is to find a husband and have children.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, wow, this is why a lot of Americans go to Ukraine to find a wife. Makes
mm-hmm.
sense to me, because they still have those old values. And I thought, wow. I talked to some, and these girls have studied. My assistant, she had 2 university degrees, and I mean, she had more degrees than I had, that's for sure. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, what's your dream? You know, because we worked through the book, and of course, I worked with her personally. And she said, you know, I want to have 5 children. I said, well, that's great. You're only 23, so no problem. And she said, yeah, and I want a husband. I said, well, don't you have any other aspirations? And she said, no, that's the main thing, really. And I said, okay. I mean, I'm not used to that, because in most countries where I work, women don't have this as the number one dream anymore, you know?
Right, right.
So I was surprised. But I said to her, so why do you study so hard? Oh, well, you need to have, you know, you need to show something to your husband. I say, yeah, but you don't study that hard and work so hard to get your degrees at such a young age just to sort of stay at home and cook.
Right.
You know, I mean, it's just not my way of thinking. I've been brought up in a different way, and I've always lived in a different mm-hmm. way. But it was
right.
so fascinating. It was so fascinating what they did to make that happen. Amazing. And in that country especially, they don't have enough men, and half of them are alcoholics. So,
I mean, it's very tough.
Unpleasant situation. So all Americans
right.
that are listening, this is where you can find yourself a beautiful wife that still has the old values. You know, the old values for females, which most of us Western women just don't carry anymore.
Right, that's right. Well, this is the thing, and a person's dream can be anything. You know, that's what I was saying. It doesn't have to be something like, you know, okay, I want to be the most richest person on the planet.
Mm.
You know, it doesn't have to be something like that. It can be just something within you that you've just always wanted to do, and this is, you know, where you'd like to see yourself end up, you know, at the end of the road. And we had a question in the chat room, and it was, this person was asking, they said, you know, when we were talking about, well, how can, you know, what about people who have like low self-esteem, and they think that they just don't deserve, they're not
very
deserving,
important.
You know?
Very good question. And I started talking about it already 3 times, I think, since we're talking,
mm-hmm.
but somehow always got distracted. I said already, number one, foundation is know what you want. Number two, believe that you can get it. I mean, that is as important as knowing what you want. Why?
Right.
Because if we don't really believe in ourselves, who will? If we don't believe that we can, we deserve this position, we deserve this type of family, we deserve this type of income, we deserve this type of body, we deserve, you know,
mm-hmm.
if we don't believe that, who will?
Yeah, that's right.
It's like, you know, you try to sell something. If you're a salesperson, you try to sell a product that you don't believe in, you're not going to be successful in it.
Mm-hmm. That's
no
right.
doubt about it. People can smell that, you know. I mean, they hear it immediately. But when you're really excited about it, you really love it. I spoke yesterday to my neighbor in Spain. I have a house in Spain. And I was talking to my neighbor, and she is really crazy about Juice Plus. And you know, this nutritional supplement.
Yeah,
and in the middle of our conversation, she started talking about it again, and I heard a 10-minute sales pitch, you know.
Yeah.
And every time that I talk to her, which is not too frequently, but every time that I talk to her, I get this pitch.
Right.
You know, and I think, no, but she obviously really seriously loves it, you know.
Right.
That's why she pitches, because she loves it. It's a need for her to tell other people, because I know that she was sickly all the time, and now, since 2 years or however long she's taking it, she feels strong, she has energy. So, yeah, she loves it. And this is why she shares it with the people that she cares about.
Mm-hmm.
And this is right. when you will sell, because she believes. And this is what we need to do about ourselves. We need to believe in ourselves. And I give lots and lots of tips in the book, so I really recommend that people get it. It's a tiny investment of, I don't know, $19 or something like that. So it's really, really very small. It's a full A to Z manual. So mm-hmm. anybody that follows it, you've already said it, you know, will really get results. However, I can give a small few small tips now. One is receive. Be a good receiver.
Mm-hmm.
If whoever asked the question was with us at the beginning of the show, when you talked about my book in the very beginning and you said how good it is and you know, that it's simple to follow and so on and so on, I said, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's right.
Yeah, and I really mean it from the heart. I didn't discuss it in that moment. I just said thank you. And so what I mean with that is be a good receiver. Really receive any praise that you get from the outside world, any praise, any compliments, mm-hmm. whatever positive comes your way, take it in. And don't push it away. This
right.
is what people with low self-esteem do. They push it away. They
right.
think that people are making fun of them. They can't mean that. You know,
right.
and they might not consciously think like that, but they should watch themselves how they react to compliments and to praise. A lot. Mm-hmm. I was like that. This is why I know so well what it feels like. I was abused as a child. I mean, after our escape from East Germany, my life was super tough for quite a few years. I was
mm-hmm.
abused. I was raped at 16. And I was a young woman with very, very, very low self-esteem, really very low. And the result was when somebody said something nice to me, I pushed them away. I thought they're mm-hmm. making fun of me. I took it in many cases as an insult, but definitely I pushed them away.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't take it. And of course, then when you are like that, you will take any criticism really strongly. Anybody that criticizes or even might criticize, you know, I mean,
mm-hmm.
they might not even say it clearly, but you take anything that could be criticism as your criticism to you personally. That is so destructive. So
yeah.
destructive. So people listening, please stop. First of all, stop taking criticism personally. That's
mm-hmm.
the first lesson. Very important.
It's a good
right.
one for me too. Yeah.
Yeah, because criticism is, first of all, just the opinion of another person.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have to be right or wrong or whatever, you know. It's just their opinion, that's all. They have a different life. They have different perceptions of things and different experience with things. So you don't have to take that personal. And
mm-hmm.
do not take it personal. Please, if you can,
right.
you know, but start noticing how you take criticism. There's two kinds of criticism. There is constructive criticism that wants to help you become better in whatever you're doing.
Right.
That those are suggestions, you know, how you can do something better. You might get that at work or at home also, maybe from your mom or whatever, that she says, okay, if you do it like this, you add a little bit of milk or you do this, then the cake will be fluffier or whatever, you know, or your omelette
right.
will be. And that's constructive criticism. This is we want to take. You know, we take it, we thank the people, and we look at it, and we see if we want to use it. That's
right.
it. We make that decision, it's our choice. So we decide, I want to use it, don't want to use it, doesn't make sense for me. Okay, but that's a criticism we can take. But destructive criticism or the general criticism that we tend to get, do not take that personal. It's very important.
Mm-hmm.
Even if you analyze it, you will see that it doesn't make sense. You know, I mean, I hear that so often. I was with the lady that does my fingernails. She was crying a few weeks ago while I was there. You know, she sort of spills her guts when I'm there.
Mm-hmm.
And so she started to cry because a friend of hers had criticized her. And I said, well, why are you taking it so personal? Why are you taking it so much to heart? She said, well, she's a friend. I said, so what? You didn't do what she criticized. You didn't even do it. So
mm-hmm.
why didn't you just have it out with her, you know, talk to her, sit down with her, have a coffee and talk to her about it and say, look, I felt really insulted. I felt hurt when I heard that, you know, but this is not how it was. And explain it to her. But she carried this with her for 3 weeks before she finally told me about it.
Right.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of damage done in those 3 weeks, I can tell you.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's right.
So criticism, very important. Don't take it too hard. If you can't cope with it, speak to the people about it.
Mm-hmm.
But please, you know what I do? When somebody criticizes me today, and that's like a personal, under-the-belt type of criticism
mm-hmm.
that we do get, I just put my hand out in a stop sign. I physically do that.
I like
I stop it. Because
good.
For me, that's a physical anchor. I
mm-hmm.
stopped it so it doesn't get to me. That's
right.
one thing. So I can really push it away from me. And the other person normally notices it also. Some people don't notice it. You know, you could even push them away. They wouldn't notice because they are so much in their own world. And that's okay. That's their thing. But
right.
I do not let that close to me. Put
mm-hmm.
my hand out. And as I'm telling you, I've got my hand in front of me in a stop sign. That's
right.
it. As far as it gets. So to build up your confidence.
Awesome.
To build up your confidence. For instance, if anything works well, today I baked a cake. I've traveled all my life. I haven't had too many opportunities to bake cakes, I must say. Just recently, in the last year or two, I started to bake cakes on a, you know, on a more regular basis. And today I baked a new cake, and it came out really well. So what do? I pat myself on the back.
Mm-hmm.
I praise myself. I
right.
live alone. I ate the cake alone.
mm-hmm.
So I can't wait for someone from the outside, you know, to praise me.
Right.
And I don't want to wait until tomorrow, until some friends come. You know, and who knows? They might not even like my cake. So
right.
I'm not waiting for that. Really, it is important that we appreciate ourselves first and foremost.
Mm-hmm.
We
You're
cannot
right.
wait until the world sees it.
You
we've
know,
got
that's
to, yeah, we've got to start with ourselves. So what I recommend, this is a technique from NLP. Anchor. You anchor everything anyway naturally because without thinking about it. But anchor it consciously. Whenever anything works, whenever you feel good about yourself, whenever you feel you've achieved something, even the tiniest little thing, like my cake, it's not nothing big, but, you know, for me, that's an achievement.
Mm-hmm.
Then pat yourself on the back. That feels a bit uncomfortable because, you know, you don't get to it too easily. I do it on my shoulder, on my left
yeah.
shoulder. So I just pat myself on my left shoulder. That's my anchor. That pat. When I need to feel confident, I can just pat that shoulder and that feeling will come back again.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's how you do it, you know, because I'm in the middle of the emotion of feeling good about my achievement. Yummy, yummy, nice
right.
cake. Great achievement, Barbara. Well done. Pat, pat, pat. You know, and this is so, so, so easy to do. And in the book, it's a three-step process. I explain first how you pet yourself. Then you start telling people about it, like I've now told you and the world, you know, about my great achievement of baking a cake. And so you might get some feedback also from the outside because you've told them, you've made them aware. And so when my friends come tomorrow, you know, if I speak to them maybe later today and I tell them, I made a nice cake for us. They wouldn't dare come here tomorrow and eat my cake without saying that it's nice, right?
right.
So you are asking for compliments. You are asking for praise. It's important.
Right.
You can't wait for it. My father never praised anybody. I mean, at
yeah.
least not my mom or me. He just didn't do that.
Right.
And so you couldn't wait for that. And I wished he had, you know, but he didn't. Was just
right.
not his way of doing things. And so first you do it like that, and then you start actually telling people about it. And start with the small things, you know. It's important that your boss knows that you are the one that, you know, does all this good stuff in your
mm-hmm.
department. How should he know? If he's the CEO of a company and you are very quiet and you're quietly doing your work, how would they know that you are the one that's actually doing all the good work?
Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't. I have a client who became a friend of mine now over the time. She was one of the very first readers of my book, and she actually put it into practice. She had a dream of working in a big bank. And she, for her, that was really important. She really wanted to do it. She then, a few months after she started working with the book and really, you know, writing her vision and dreaming her vision every day, so really using the book, within 3 months she got headhunted by a big bank, I think second biggest bank in America. She got the job that she wanted. And now in the last year, and I think about a year and 2 months or something like that, that she said she had two promotions.
Mm-hmm.
The CEO of that bank knows her by name and actually talks to her when he's there. So, I mean, this is what happens, because you start standing up for yourself. You stand tall. You start to be proud of yourself, of you know what you want. You go out and get it. And I don't mean you get it with your elbows. You get it with your heart and with your soul, because
mm-hmm.
that's what you put into it, your heart and your soul. And people start noticing that.
Right, right. It becomes it because you wear it on the outside too.
Mm-hmm.
You're showing it on the outside, and people can see that. And it's you know, so true. And you're right. So yeah, for anybody who may be suffering from low self-esteem and thinking, you know, do I even deserve to have a good life? And you know, do I even deserve to have my dream life? You know, or to go after these goals? Or you know, it. You know, I just like to encourage people myself. You know, that absolutely we do deserve. We do deserve that, just like everyone else. You know what I mean?
Sure.
We have to be our own best advocates. We have to be our own best friends, like you were saying, Barbara. You know, you can't wait for others to pat you on the back, because they may not. So you have to start doing it yourself. I have to start doing that myself and recognize these little things. They could be just small things within the day, like, okay, I did my Taibo, or I cut down to, you know, I cut down my smoking by half pack this week or whatever. And just these little accomplishments that to somebody else wouldn't necessarily mean anything, but to me it's a big thing, and it's something I should be proud of and should be happy about, because it is it's a step in the right direction. It's something that made me happy. It's something that gave me a little bit of confidence and boosted
mm-hmm.
my confidence or whatever. You know, we can pat ourselves. Yeah, we don't. And you're right about the criticism thing. You know, like so many times I know myself, I have a huge issue with that. And I take everything everybody says personally, right? I mean, it doesn't even have to be directed to me. I'll be picking it up as mine. And I think it's just the way I grew up, being, you know, just kind of being bombshelled with so much, you know, abuse around me. I just can't help but pick up other stuff and
yeah,
take
but
it
now
time.
you can help it. You see,
yeah, see that
alone.
Right.
Listen to your language. I just can't help it. That's not true. You can help it. It does take some doing. But you are aware of it, so that's already a big step. Now that you are aware of it, you can do something about it. So, you know, don't tell yourself, nothing I can do about it, or I can't help it. You can help it, and you can do something about it. It just, once we are aware of whatever we have, you know, we all have our shortcomings. I mean, no doubt about it. Once you are aware what it is that you want to change, then with that awareness being in place, you will start to listen to yourself. For instance, I used to always say to myself, oh, how stupid of you. You know, when I forgot something or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, how stupid
right.
of you. And, yeah, but this is,
I think
know,
a lot
you
of
start
people
to feel stupid. Yeah, you start to feel stupid. You tell yourself that 2-3 times a day. You start to feel stupid because
mm-hmm.
your subconscious doesn't know the difference between reality and between fantasy. This is why visualizing and really being emotional about your dreams is so important. And so I became aware of it, and I started saying it less and less, but I still catch myself after years. I still catch myself sometimes. And my niece, for instance, she went with me to the States. I took her with me when I was speaking at the Festival of Enlightenment in Colorado in June. And so she spent, for the first time ever, we spent 8 days together, and I love her to bits. So for me, that was paradise to have her along. And I told her about these kind of things. And she told me twice. She said, "Hey, you just said it." I said, "Oh, God, you know, still amazing. Yeah, this is so deep within us. We don't even think about it. We don't think how destructive it is to our own belief in ourselves. And our subconscious is much stronger than our conscious. That means our will alone, your willpower will not let you stop smoking."
Mm-hmm.
Because that's just not enough. That's just 3 to 5% of your thoughts.
Right.
So that means you need to get your emotions going. Paint a good picture of what life will be like when you don't smoke anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You know, paint that picture of that beautiful outcome. Your skin is going to look better. Your purse is going to be fatter. Your lung will definitely look cleaner a little while, you know, after you started, stopped doing it, and all kinds of things. But look at yourself first. That's the main thing, really, because the other stuff we don't really care so much about. We know we should, but we don't.
Mm-hmm.
But we ladies, we like to look good. So, you know, know that if you don't smoke anymore, your skin is going to start looking better, because our skin definitely gets destroyed by smoke.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, just look at the outcome that you want and then say, feel the emotion. You have to really feel joyful when you think, oh, I'm a non-smoker and this is what life will be like as a non-smoker. So you paint that picture.
Mm-hmm.
You want to see the picture of the outcome. And that, of course, goes for any outcome that we want. We need to feel the emotion. We have to. The emotion is what gets our subconscious, wakes our subconscious up, and lets it help us. And it really, really works. I mean, everybody that's listening, when I am clearly focused on a goal, on anything, then I always achieve it. Even the crazy stuff, you know, also small stuff that is not important, but I'm focused on it, and boom, it happens. I'm just starting a new Toastmasters club, and I am 100% sure it's going to happen within a very short period of time if I stay focused on it. Here we don't have one in the whole, I don't know, 100 kilometers around us. No Toastmasters club, and I love Toastmasters. So I decided a couple of weeks ago I'm going to start one. Again, I already found another 4 Toastmasters that have the same idea but haven't taken action. So now we're taking action, and it's going to happen.
That's awesome.
It's like that, you know. You make a decision. You have a dream, you make a decision. Okay, now is my time. I'm going to make it happen. And everybody listening, even if you don't feel like it, you are good enough and you do deserve it. Every one of us does. And if you have a dream, that means that you have the skills and ability and resources that you need to make that dream come true. Otherwise, you wouldn't have that.
Mm-hmm.
It might take some time.
Yeah, that's right.
It doesn't happen overnight.
No, that's right. And that's just it. And it's not easy, and there could be obstacles, you know. Like, I think a lot of times people think, well, you know, what if, or, you know, like in your book where you said the chapter, but what if, you know, what if it doesn't work, or what if this, or what if that. And so many times, you know, they may have gotten started on it and then hit a little bit of a brick wall and then think, oh, yeah, it's just proof that it's not going to work. And, you know, so many times we'll just hold ourselves back on these things. And I just say it's worth trying. And you know, that's that whole glass is half full thing. You know, it's like it's worth a try, because if you fail, well, you know, there's really no such thing as fail, if you ask me. There's no such thing. Because as long as you're trying, you know, and then you can learn from that experience. And you can just,
I think it's more than trying, because we really need to say, okay, this is what I'm going to do. Make a clear intention, not let's try. Let's try is kind of, let's try. If it doesn't work, I can still do something else. That will not work, because it's like, you know, try to sit down. I mean, anybody listening, try it out. Get up and then try to sit down. There is no such thing. Either you sit down or you keep standing. There is no try to sit down. And when we were little toddlers, and we learned how to walk, we tried, yeah, but our intention was always to walk.
Right.
We never said to ourselves, oh, I'm going to try to walk. And when we tried it once or twice and it didn't work, we gave up and we said, okay, I'm not going to walk. This doesn't work for me.
Right.
No. And why do we do it different as adults? You know, people, they work so hard and they try, and this is really the point. They try to do something, achieve something, and then it doesn't work at first trial. Well, which is normal, really, because they don't have experience yet, so why should it work, you know? So they try, doesn't work. Of course, they have some well-meaning friends who say, oh, I told you, you know.
Right.
So that's, okay, forget them. It's just not their dream, so that's okay. For them, it probably wouldn't work, but for you, it will, because it is your dream and you really want it. And then don't give up after the first trial. When it doesn't work, look at the lesson. Look what you can learn from the failure or from the challenge that is arising from the hurdle. Look at the lesson that can be learned from this. What didn't work? What can I do better the next time? And if you go about it like that and you don't give up, I mean, Edison did 10,000 trials before he finally invented the light bulb.
Right.
10,000! You know, none of us have to do 10,000, none of us. But
right.
at least we should give it 5 or 10 if it's our
right.
dream. And sort of, if it doesn't work first time, then maybe that was not the right approach. You know, then really analyze it, look at it, and say, okay, that didn't work so well. What could I do better? Then adjust your course a little bit and do it again. And if that doesn't work so well, then look, did it work better than the first time or did it work worse? If it worked worse, well, then obviously that definitely no good. Learn the lesson. Each time learn the lesson. And after a few times, you get better and better and better. I mean, there is no, in German we have the saying, no master falls from the heavens.
So
we need to become a master by making mistakes. This is how we become masterful in anything. Do you think that the sportsmen achieve when they first start trying?
Mm-hmm.
They don't.
Right.
They have lots and lots and lots of losses before they finally win.
Right.
But
that's right.
Yeah, but they didn't give up. They continued. And sometimes they're at the max of what they can do. Like I remember Tiger Woods, I don't know how many years ago, but some years ago, he stopped for almost a year. He was at the top of his game, and he just couldn't get any better. He just couldn't get any better.
Mm-hmm.
And he knew that he was at the max. And then he took a mental coach, and he totally changed his play. Within 1 year, he became number one again. But he totally, totally changed his game.
Mm-hmm.
He reinvented his game. He lost millions. But after that, he made more millions, of course. And why?
It just shows you.
Yeah, it just showed you that he thought good, you know, he was one of the best five or something in the world, but for him that was not good enough. He wanted to be number one constantly, and this is why he knew he'd reached his limit. I need some help so that I can adjust my game and get even better.
Mm-hmm.
And he did.
Right.
That's commitment.
Yes, it is. Absolutely. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, it's kind of like the saying, you know, I mean, you're right. I mean, you know, just do it. Just do it. You know, because you're right. I mean, you know, I completely understand what you're saying as far as trying and the difference between try and do. Because, you know, you're so right when you say that. I know that so many times, like, if we're going to put something in, let's say, like you say, when you're a small child, you don't just say, oh, I'm going to try to walk or I'm going to try to learn to talk.
Mm-hmm.
You just do it. You know what I mean? And then as an adult, I think what it, maybe that comes from past failures, you know, maybe some, you know, looking at ourselves like, oh, well, it was good effort, you know. You know, and maybe almost just afraid to say, no, I'm going to do it. And because anything that I recognize in myself that I've done in life has been a situation where I just said, I'm doing it. And I just, and there's no try, there's no, oh, I'll give it a try or anything. It's just, I'm doing it. And I can look back on a few different areas in my life where, a few different times in my life where that actually did happen. And it just made it happen. And it just did it. And that's it. And then you're right. This, for instance, with you know, with my smoking addiction, it's never going to work if I keep trying. I can
exactly,
try
yeah.
I want. You know what I mean? I can try for the rest of my life, and it's not going to happen. I need to just do it. So
yeah,
you know,
you need to really decide.
Yeah.
And you know, find a good opportunity and decide and just do it.
That's right. So that's like. So this is a good example of what we can do, you know, as for people, you know, who are saying, oh, I don't know if I could ever achieve my dream life, you know, and I don't know if I have what it takes, and just do it, you know. We have to make that commitment.
Yeah, we have to make that commitment. Exactly. It's it's like when you're always sort of just doing things half-heartedly because you haven't really committed to it, because then you might fail.
Right.
That's a possibility, right? Even so, you're 100% committed and you're doing everything in your power, you might still fail. There's a small possibility for that. And that is, of course, then fearful, because then you might have burned your bridges. And sometimes we need to do that. When my father decided that we need to escape from communist Germany, for him, that was essential because he wanted to be an entrepreneur and communists didn't allow that. So for him, that was a decision he needed to make. And we had everything. We had our own house. We had a car. I mean, I'm talking about the 50s. That was not normal. We had the first private telephone line in the village. We had the first private TV in the village. I mean, we were somebody in that village, right? Important, well off. And my father still decided that this was not enough because that was not his dream. They were trying to restrict him. They were trying to suppress him. And he said, I don't stand for that. That's not who I am. And he took the family and off he went. Under danger of his life, he burnt his bridges. We arrived in West Germany with zero, just the clothes on our back. And you know, I mean, with a child, you don't do that very easily. But he did, because his dream was big enough, was strong enough, that he had to make it happen. He just had to. And it took him many years, but he never gave up. I saw that. You know, I didn't understand it, but I saw it. I watched it. For him, it was, my father was so driven that nothing else was important, really. You know, I mean, we lived in this tiny little attic room for at least 3 years. It was horrible. I hated it. The whole family, one small room, no bathroom or anything, no kitchen. And my father didn't mind. For him, this is, you know, okay, we can't afford more right now, and we need to save money because we want to, you know, grow. And for him, that was no hardship at all. I talked to him later on in life, you know, when I understood. And he said, no, that was, for me, the hard part was that you suffered so much, but for me it was not hard, and for him it was not hard.
Right. Because that was his goal, that was his drive.
That was his drive,
vision.
Yeah, 100% committed, 100% committed. When Cortez conquered America, they say that he had 400 ships or something like that, and he had them all burned. No, 400 ships, no, 40 ships. And he had them all burned because the odds of winning for his few people were very small. So he didn't want to give them a way to fall back on. They had to win or die.
Right.
There was no other option, and they won. Only because they had that attitude, they know that there was no turning back.
Right, right.
And sometimes we must make that leap of faith and really say, okay, either win or die. And I know that's tough. And I let me tell you how I deal with fear. Very simple. Because fear comes up no matter where you are. When you try something new, when you want to turn your life around, when you... You know, I mean, in many situations in our life, but especially when we are changing, a fear comes up, we are fearful. And when the fear, I mean, there's two different types of fear. One is physical fear, that makes sense. For instance, if you want to cross a very busy crossing, you better look left and right and make sure that there's no car coming, you know, that might run you over. That makes sense. That fear is there for a reason. But when we're born, we have two fears. One is of loud noise, and the other one is of falling. Those are the two fears that we're born with, nothing else. Everything else is educated into us, is learned. That means we can educate it out of us also. That's the good news.
We can unlearn that.
We can unlearn, yes. Not so easy, but we can.
I like
do
that.
It.
Yeah, that's great. I think that's
and
awesome.
It really is, and it really is too. The most, for us, the biggest fears are emotional fears. The fear of failure. Why do we need to be afraid?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so what? So we fail. We fail anyway, whether we fear it or not. I mean, we do fail in life sometimes, you know. And there's nothing wrong with it because that's how we learn our lessons. But we have that fear. And the worst fear is the fear of success. That's a fear that, oh, my God, when I discovered that, I thought, wow, Barbara, you fear to be successful. There's a fear there when you think about it. That's nuts. That's insane, crazy. But we fear that. And
yeah.
I don't know if you know this wonderful poem by Marianne Williamson that I have in the beginning of my book. That is, let me check it out. I want to read it. It's so lovely. I love it. Some of the most powerful words I've ever heard in my whole life. That is, our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightened us.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah. Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. It is that we are powerful beyond measure.
Right.
And this has been proven. We just have to look into history and even today. Why do some people become so extremely powerful and other people with similar backgrounds become nothing?
Right.
Why is that? Because that person that became so powerful or so successful, this person had a dream and believed that he or she could make it happen. They believed and they took the necessary steps to make it happen.
Right.
That is the only secret, and I've studied success for, I don't know, you know, decades.
Right.
And the essence is those three things. They know what they want, they believe they can make it happen, and they take action until it has happened. Until it has happened, they don't try and give up halfway. They just continue against all odds.
Right.
And
we
only meet those people or hear about these people when they're at the very top of their game.
Right.
And we think, look at these guys, how lucky. Bill Gates, for instance, how lucky.
Right.
Look at him. 40 years old, richest man in the world. Oh, a lucky guy, you know, right time. Yeah, but before he started Microsoft, he had more than 10,000 hours of programming under his belt. 10,000 hours, you know how much that is? Does anybody talk about it? No.
Right.
He was just lucky. He wasn't lucky. He was committed.
Right.
And he had a big dream. He had that dream of a computer in every household. And look where, and isn't that the truth today?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is. Pretty
and
much.
So,
yeah,
pretty much so. Pretty much so. At least in the Western world, for sure, a computer in every household. And he just did it step by step by step by step. And he had to conquer a lot of obstacles. And today he's using this immense wealth for good. I love him for that. I didn't used to like him before so much because his programs are so expensive. But now I buy his program because I know that part of it will go back, you know, and help people less fortunate. This guy is incredible. He is not only spending half of his wealth, he also got 50 or so other billionaires to put half of their wealth into this foundation. And some people, like Warren Buffett, they give 85% of their wealth. I love them.
Awesome. Yeah.
I mean, this is billions and billions of dollars that go to social causes. And I applaud them and really appreciate what they're doing, every little thing that they're doing, because we need people like that. And what's the difference between these guys and us? They had a dream. They believed that they could make it happen, and they did whatever it took to make it happen. And
that's right.
Yeah, and this is the secret, really. And your results depend how much you believe and how much action you take.
Right.
And I don't mean with action how much you keep yourself busy.
No.
You know, I mean, we can be on Facebook all day and read our emails and chat and do all kinds of stuff. That doesn't bring us anywhere unless we build a strong network, maybe, and we do all of this to build that strong network.
Right.
But otherwise, it's just a social time. It's like we used to go and have a drink in a pub.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and now we have that drink or we have that talk through the internet.
Right. Yeah.
So, you know, some people confuse that. They say, yeah, but I'm on my computer all day. I'm on my computer very often until 2, 3 at night. But I don't always work.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And sometimes I don't want to admit that.
Well, that's just it, right? It's like, but I was busy all day, like busy doing what? Yeah, you're so right. And I think that, you know, that's where, you know, I think that your workbook is helpful. And I think that so many people can benefit from this workbook because it's easy to follow. And it's something that you can pull out, and you can do the steps. Like you said, some of it requires, you know, more thinking than others, and some of it really requires time to really discover what it is that within you, within us, you know, that we need to bring to the surface so we can understand where we want to end up and what our real vision is and what our real goal is. But it's a great tool, and I think that, you know, that will definitely help me, because I'm going to do the book from the beginning to the end, and I'm going to sign it and everything, my commitment to doing it, and I'm going to, you know, I think it by doing that, that'll really sort of help me to see that, wow, there is lots of times that I think, oh, I had such a busy day, but what did I really do to accomplish what I needed to do for my dream? Was it mainly just sitting around, you know, discussing things or chatting or you know, staring off into space and smoking cigarettes, or was I really working on it? And so, you know, I think that this is really good, and I think it's very, very helpful for people. I hope people will definitely take a look at your website, take a look at your books. And I know I posted the actual your websites in the chat room. We have about 10 minutes left, and I did pop all your links into the chat room. But just for people who are listening, you know, live, listening somewhere else, they're not in the chat room, there are some people listening elsewhere, and people who are listening to the archive, you know, be sure and check out Barbara Hofmeister's website, because you also work, you do training sessions, and you have, like, some great things happening. Maybe you could tell us about that.
Yeah, first of all, where can people find me? I have a hub site. With hub site, I mean, from that hub site, you can decide where you want to go, to the book page, or you want to go to my blog, or you want to go to the coaching site, or to my social media sites. So that's BarbaraHofmeister.com, Hofmeister with one F, so it's BarbaraHofmeister.com, BarbaraHofmeister.com. That's my hub site. And the book website is www.thetobebook.com. And you can get the book, of course, on Amazon. And you can get it on the book website. If you get it from the book website, it will take a little longer because I'm sending it from Germany. But I will promise to sign it for you. So I think that's a good incentive for anybody
that's awesome.
That wants the physical book. You can also get the ebook, but I recommend the physical one. Get it from the book website, and I will personally sign it for you
that's awesome.
Send it to you.
That's very, very cool. And you, and I know you have a blog talk show here as well. And
I do have a blog talk show. Yeah, that's blogtalkradio.com/Barbara. And
awesome.
I also have a YouTube channel, and that's youtube.com/trainingvisions.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why I used that name, but anyway, that's the name I used at the time.
I do things like that, too.
And if people want to see the Moments to Be, you can actually go to my blog, and I've posted lots of my Moments to Be on there. The
mm-hmm.
first CD is already printed, so if anybody wants the first 20 Moments to Be, they can get it from the book website, too. And they can leave comments there. I love comments. I love talking to, you know, my clients and people who are interested in my work. I want to hear what results you're getting, you know, what challenges are you rising up while you're doing this work. I want to hear all of that stuff so that,
mm-hmm.
first of all, because I can help you. Second, you know, I can learn from it and do it better the next time. And,
right.
And all of that. So I am very, very interested. I always communicate directly. Even on Facebook, I write my own stuff. I don't. I have somebody that posts sometimes on Twitter, for instance. They post quotes and things for me. But I actually check my Facebook page every day, and I answer whatever questions come up or remarks. I always do that myself. So
mm-hmm.
if people want to communicate with me directly, it's very easy to do.
That's awesome. That's great. Well, I know I was on your website and the training visions and looking around at what you do, and I noticed that people, you know, people can get involved. People can sign up to be part of the, you know, some real focused training sessions
mm-hmm.
with you. And are you still doing these? And can people still contact you and to you know, get involved with the
sure.
mastermind?
Yeah, sure. I run mastermind groups.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the To Be Mastermind focus group. This is really for people who are committed, who want to take their life to the next level. And
mm-hmm.
I really want committed people in there. Why? Because masterminding means that you will get an accountability partner. We work in very, very small groups, maximum 12 people, in many cases just 6 people or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And you have direct access to me. We talk every week, and we talk online every week. And we really get down to the nitty-gritty of your life, what isn't working, where are you stuck, what can be done about it, what are your dreams, what do we as a group have that can help you? Because as you can imagine, 6, 10, 12 people, we have so many resources between us, and each
mm-hmm.
each member in a mastermind group, because that's what masterminding is all about, will help the rest of the group. And
mm-hmm.
so we really put our heads together. We brainstorm ideas. If somebody has a business idea they want to discuss or whatever it might be, this is really, really powerful stuff, but you must make a commitment that I do a private interview with every person that actually joins the mastermind group. Why? Because, yeah, you need people with commitment. Otherwise,
mm-hmm.
imagine one of them says, okay, I come this week, but then I don't turn up for the next 3 weeks because I don't feel
right.
like it. And then, of course, your accountability partner will be stuck because they don't have a partner. So
mm-hmm.
it has to work for all, and all have to work to make it work.
Right, that's right. And like, and just for people that didn't know, you know, that you have a whole lot of great information, like on your websites,
mm-hmm.
tools and programs, like CDs and DVDs and different things like this. To help people, to help in, you know, like if I was really interested in going another step further, you know, like working through the to be or not to be, the choice is yours, and then I decide, okay, I'd like to go a little bit further, I can get a hold of your stuff on your websites, and you have a lot of great information there, and I'm excited about it, and I hope that people will go take a look and really, you know, we can all do this. This is not just for somebody else. Right.
This is sometimes funny that people say, yeah, that sounds really interesting, and I know a friend who could do with this. I think every one of us could do with it, and I use it myself. I mean, I go through my book once a year, and sometimes I really do the whole book from beginning to end.
Yeah.
Why? Because things change as our life progresses, you know, we change,
right.
we move forward. and things change. It's really interesting also to look back and see, interesting. Yeah, this is done and this is done and this is done. This one didn't work.
Right.
What happened there?
Right.
Very interesting. Very interesting. Because life is flow all the time. We flow backwards or we flow forwards. And I choose to flow forwards always.
Right. Well, and that's awesome. And this is, that's right. If a person picks up the book, we can go back through it, because some of our dreams might have changed. It might have gone in a different direction. And we might have decided, but this is what I really want to do. And because in finding out, it's sort of like learning about ourselves all the time, working through that, learning about what our goals are, what our vision is. And sometimes that vision may change a bit.
Mm.
And so I think that's so great. I love what you've done. You've just made it tangible for everybody to get a hold of, and I love it. So I'll be sharing this around everywhere. And I'm thankful to you for coming on the show, Barbara. This is so wonderful. And thank you for taking this time, it's 2 hours out of your day to do this. And this means a lot to me. I know that it does to a lot of people. And I know a lot of listeners will probably really benefit from this. We have quite a few people here in the chat room, and there were other people here online as well, listening on the actual switchboard. So thank you so much for doing this.
Well, thank you so much for having me, Lori. It's been a pleasure. Anytime again, and everybody that's listening, if, you missed something, just you can listen in the archives or just get in touch with me.
Mm-hmm.
And, it's always my pleasure, and this is my purpose and my mission in life, really, to help people succeed and really get unstuck and start moving their life up to the next level and start really living it full and enjoying it. And nobody that listens to me for any length of time will doubt that I enjoy what I do. So
that's right.
Yeah, and you all have the same right. You all have that right to really love what you do and really enjoy it. And I believe that my book will definitely help you go in that direction, become clear of where you want to go, understand the reasons why you are stuck maybe, or why it hasn't been going your way so well. You will start to understand that. You will start to understand the beliefs that have been holding you back, what you can do about it, how you can change things, and really start moving bit by bit by bit until you wake up one day and you think, wow.
Yeah.
This is it.
There it is.
Yeah.
There it is. Yeah. That's awesome. I know. Well, I'm looking forward to see, just to going through the workbook. I will be sure and get a hold of you and let you know how that's going. And
I want to hear all about it. Definitely.
Just let you know. I think it's wonderful, and I just love what you're doing. And I'm excited to see now. I'll be watching. I'll be watching here from over here in Canada to see what you're doing next. it's just exciting. I love what you're a great inspiration to a lot of people. And so thank you for doing what you do and for being who you are. This kind, passionate, kind, and caring person. And the world, it definitely needs you. And so thank you so much
for sharing yourself. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for saying that. I really appreciate that, really, really do. And if you get a chance, write a review on Amazon or on the book website, because that will help people understand, what the book is all about.
That's right. I will. I'll do that.
I'll be
sure to do that. Well, thank you, Barbara.
Speak to you soon. Have a lovely weekend, everybody, and have an even better life.
That's right. That's right. Awesome. Bye, Barbara. You take good care.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, everybody, for being here. Appreciate that so much. We had so many people tuning in on the chat room and people on the switchboard, and I thank you so much for being here. And this was, a two-hour show, quite lengthy, but thank you, and take good care of yourself. Have a beautiful weekend. If I can get you any information, please get a hold of me here on Blog Talk Radio. And be sure and tune into Barbara's shows, Barbara Hofmeister on Blog Talk Radio. That's blogtalkradio.com/Barbara, B-A-R-B-A-R-A. And she's got amazing guests on her shows. And I have only caught a few of her shows. Actually, I've only caught two of her shows. And because I'm like I said, I'm just busy, not doing much. I plan on tuning in a little bit more often. She's got some great people on her shows, great information. Be sure to tune in. So have a great weekend, everybody. Take good care of yourself. Bye-bye.